as you may well have guessed from our opening track, Lifted, which was a hit in 1996, we are welcoming the voice of Lighthouse Family, Tunde Bayo.
Hi, Jackie. How are you?
I'm good. How are you doing?
I'm fine. Thank you. Fine.
Brilliant. Lovely to speak to you. Thank you very much for taking the time.
Oh, pleasure. Anytime.
So you've been performing as part of the lineup for the Rewind Festivals. How did that go?
That was amazing. Rewind was in front of 18,000 people, and the atmosphere was just amazing. And I have to say, it brought a tear to my eye because...
Did it?
You know, yeah, because, you know, you think, well, you're there in front, the sun is shining, the sky is blue, and you're singing songs like Ocean Drive and Lifted and High, and everybody's singing that stuff back. They're singing with you, really, to be honest with you. It was such a celebratory moment that it kind of, it was quite emotional. And because, like I said before, you know, hadn't done anything like that for quite a while.
Yeah.
You kind of think to yourself, ooh, there's a lot of, you know, I was looking forward to it. It was exciting. But at the same time, I was a bit nervous because you're just not sure what the reception is going to be like. And but we went out there and it was just amazing. I enjoyed the show. It was like fantastic. And the feedback we got, you know, on social media has just been like amazing. So it's kind of, it lit the spark again and kind of, you know, set us all on the right track for the Rewind Festival.
And I always think it must be such great fun to be an artist at those festivals because, you know, you've got your set to do, particularly after you've done your set, you can probably relax and actually just sort of stand in the wings or go down and watch other people, right? Then your bit's over with.
Yeah.
Out of the many, many festivals you'll have played, who have you been particularly impressed with in terms of your peers?
You know, because when you're backstage, everybody's kind of, you know, in the dressing room, kind of just loitering around and kind of your heart's pounding away. You're thinking, oh, who's on now? So, yeah, I mean, Chesney Hawks, he was great. You know, heard him. You don't really get to see much, especially when you're in the dressing room area because it's quite away from the where the stage is. So, but like I heard him and he sounded amazing. I was next door to Heather Small, who I know. I've met her a few times. I supported her on one of her tours. She's just like a lovely person. And and she was on after me. So just as I came off stage during my set, there she was backstage. And I said, listen, there they are. I've warmed them up for you. So you can, you can now just go and get them.
Number two in 1993, festival and tour buddy to tonight's special guest, Tunde Bayo, Heather Small and M People with Moving On Up. Well, listen, Tunde, as we are wont to do on this show, we always like to take kind of a deep dive into your background. In terms of the music that's influenced you or been significant to you, do you remember the first record that you bought that we would know, you know, from British charts? Do you have a recollection of what that might be?
I can't really remember the first record I bought, but if I were to really step back and go, let's put it this way. When I was a child growing up in London till the age of four, five, six, around that time, before we relocated back to Nigeria, I remember my dad used to, he had a lot of all those sort of like Jim Reeves albums.
Oh, did he?
So there was that, and that was part of it. But I remember specifically when I moved back to Nigeria, and that was in the 70s. Strangely enough, on the radio, there was a lot of people like James Taylor. I was a big fan of James Taylor.
Oh, right.
James Taylor was always on the radio in Nigeria. In fact, I'm sure some artists even re-recorded some of those songs of his that were popular. But also growing up in Nigeria as a kid, I mean, you know, there were people like Fela Kuti, who's just like he's a household name in Nigeria, and Sunny Ade and stuff like that. But I remember like also a lot of the sort of early, those like soul R&B groups like The Whispers, Shalamar, Barkays. Those are the kind of things I kind of listened to as a kid growing up. But I have to say, as a child, I was just a huge fan of James Taylor.
Oh, okay.
And I remember as a kid, when I used to listen to some of those songs, because they told stories. They were meaningful songs that had, you know, stood the test of time, a lot of those songs. But I think James Taylor is, for me,
was your big influence.
He's who I'd like gravitate to.
When you're down and trouble, you've got a friend.
You've Got a Friend, a hit for James Taylor in 1971. And our first musical memory for tonight's special guest joining us for our great conversation. And we'll be back with more Top Chat from Tunde Bayou next. Welcome back to The Evening Show with Jackie Brambles, where it's just you, me, and tonight's special guest, Tunde Bayou, the voice of Lighthouse Family, cozying on in for a great conversation and taking a deep dive into his most meaningful musical memories. And before the break, Tunde, we were talking about the music that you were exposed to both here in the UK, where you were born, and where for the first few years of your life, when you moved to Nigeria as a child, for the next 10 years. And when you came back to the UK, it was at Newcastle University, wasn't it, that you...
Yes, Northumbria University in Newcastle, yeah. There are two universities in Newcastle. There's Newcastle University and then there's Northumbria University.
And you're at Northumbria, okay. I want to be clear about that, want to get that right.
Yeah.
and were you sort of, at that point, did you know that you wanted to do something in music? I know that's where you met your musical partner there. What sort of stage were you at in your musical development?
Well, I had always had a love and interest in music because, as I said, growing up in Nigeria as a kid, one of the things that my mum did when I was quite young, and just to, you know, keep kids out of trouble, really, and give you something important to do, was she enrolled me in the church choir.
Right.
So I had always been one of the choristers in the church from a young age. So I'd always sang from that age. But when I was up in Newcastle, I remember one of the things, you know, because these were back in the days where, you know, you could easily, there were like record stores strewn all over Newcastle, and vinyl was a big thing. So I used to like just go and pick up vinyl records. I had a huge stack of, I don't even know where they are now, stack of vinyl records. So
yeah,
I was interested in music. I loved music, like the Michael Jacksons and all that sort of stuff.
It from Michael Jackson got to number three in 1983, one of the Jackson hits that first caught the attention of a young Tunde Bayou returning from Nigeria to go to university in Newcastle. And at uni, Tunde, did you have any kind of notion that you were set for this career as a successful musical artist?
I never really thought too much of myself as somebody that would be the maker of music. Like, you know, I just loved it as somebody who listened to music, bought records, and I'd sing in the shower. But that's how it all started. I remember one of my housemates at the time, when we were at university, Kieran Maguire, he would hear me singing in the shower, and he'd say, "Oh man, you're not bad, your voice is not bad, we should start a band and stuff." So we started this little band that we put together, because the plan was to start doing little pub gigs.
Yeah.
So what we would do, we'd go and rehearse and all these Wilson Pickett songs and stuff like that. On the back of that, what had happened was I had some friends who were also studying music technology in Newcastle at the time. And, you know, I don't know if you, one of the things that they used to get as part of their coursework or projects from college was to actually deliver a fully produced track.
Ah, right.
Record a track. And so some of those friends of mine, I had recorded on some of those, it was part of their coursework,
yeah,
really.
Yeah, and you got some free studio time.
Yeah, and so, and I just used to love it, go in the studio and sing on some of those songs.
Do you remember what songs you would do for those projects that they had to turn in?
Well, one of them was a pirate radio DJ. And what he used to do was play some of those songs on his radio show because he thought they were so good. And then unbeknownst to me, they also even sent some of those songs or to like record labels.
Wow.
Because they just thought they were good. I mean, for me, it was just a bit of fun. I was enjoying singing and looking at the flashing lights in a recording studio. You know, it kind of always, it's always beguiling. And then shortly after that, what had happened was Paul, I think he had a song, Ocean Drive, that he had it for a long time. I didn't know him at the time.
Right.
But he then started looking around for a singer because he just felt this song, he felt it was special and he felt he wanted to get it out of his system and just record it. So he had spoken to some of those people I was doing stuff with, Wayne McDonald in particular. And he had asked, "Oh, do you know anybody who can sing?" And Wayne said, "Oh, yeah, I know. Tunde can do that for you." And that's how Paul and I met. And that was just the genesis of the whole thing. It's true, Camp Blue.
The sun's gonna shine on everything. Ocean Drive, first released in 1995, got to number 34, but when it was re-released the following year, it got to number 11 and really launched Lighthouse Family. So were you absolutely, you know, shocked when it took off as it did?
I was the reluctant one of the two. Like, so when we recorded some of those songs, you know, unbeknownst to me again, so they'd sent some of that stuff out to record labels and publishers. They just thought, oh, it was good. And when we started getting calls back to say, oh, come down to London to see people at Island Records and Polydor and stuff.
Yeah.
I was kind of quite reluctant, to be honest, because I had just finished college at university and, you know, and I used to think, well, you know, as this, with my African roots, Nigerian roots in particular, and strict parenthood, I just couldn't imagine myself going back to my mum and saying, no, I've spent these years up here studying accountancy, but now I'm going off on a tangent to do this thing called music.
That wouldn't have gone down well.
Exactly. So I was quite reluctant. Paul would say, oh, come on, let's go. You know, it's good. They want to see us, blah, blah, blah. So it kind of worked off in our favor in a way, because it always turned out to be like the good cop, bad cop situation.
Yeah.
Where
yeah.
Paul was quite, you know, keen and stuff, and you know, we'd speak to all these like record company executives and people, but I was kind of always standing on the fence,
right?
Because I just wasn't really sure if it was truly a viable thing for me to, like, you know, throw myself into wholeheartedly.
Do you remember at that time when you were sort of, you know, you were getting traction and you were getting this interest, you know, and talking to record companies and things, who would have been your artistic peers at that time that we would know, who was also just about to break through, just about to get there?
Well, I could tell you some of the ones that I knew who had just broken through.
Go on then.
And that was in particular like a Soul to Soul.
Oh, wow.
And yeah, and I'm a big fan of Soul to Soul. I love Soul to Soul. And yeah, so that was the kind of stuff just coming off. I mean, we're talking about, like, you know, early 90s.
Yeah.
You know, we used to listen, like, you go to the clubs, and Soul to Soul was always on the radio and in the clubs. So we were huge fans, and that was the thing. So, I mean, just like you said, you know, if you think about it, I think, well, Soul to Soul, you know, they're getting big. This is a huge, I just never imagined that we would be able to sort of, like you say, get that sort of traction.
Yeah.
Because for me, for us, it was just, we loved doing it and we enjoyed writing songs. And I just discovered that I suppose growing up in Nigeria and being in a choir since I was a kid, I just had a natural knack for doing certain musical things.
Yeah, yeah.
And a lot of that fed into what we were doing. You know, Paul and I remember we'd be in the studio, in our small little studio, once we got signed, and we just talk all day and talk about music. And a lot of the ideas for a lot of the songs we wrote in those early days came from that.
Yeah, from those conversations.
Yeah. Back to life, back to reality.
Number one in 1989. I just think that's a perfect record, isn't it? I just love that. Soul to Soul, Back to Life. Much admired by and just a few steps ahead of the Lighthouse Family when they were trying to break through. And we will be back to hear what happened next with our special guest, Tunde Bayo, next. Jackie Brambles with you on the evening show, and we're having a really great conversation with tonight's special guest, the voice of Lighthouse Family, Tunde Bayo. And before the break, we were talking, Tunde, about the time when you were trying to break through. So when it did happen, do you remember, you know, the first time you heard your music on the radio, or the first TV show that you did?
Yeah. Well, one of the first times we heard, I remember we were, because we had to go and do a lot of these little promotion gigs, and, you know, for when the record was coming out. So the record company put us, they had a little small minibus for us.
Right.
And we were like on the motorway, you know, going all the way. We were going to Scotland, I actually think, at the time. And I remember I can't remember which song it was. If it was either Ocean Drive or Lifted, it was one of those two. And we heard it on the radio for the first time. In fact, it was such a shock for us. I remember we stopped the car and pulled up in one of the gas stations. Like, we were so excited about the whole thing. It's like, oh my God, look, our song was on the radio. You know, I mean, it charted at the time. I think it was in the either 30s or 40s, but
right.
We were just over the moon.
Of course.
Like, oh, this is great. You know, it was very, very, very excited. And I remember shortly after that, and then there was a second single, same sort of thing, went in at 40-something. And then a few months later, the record company, they came to us and said, oh, you know, we're going to have to go back and re-release, you know, those first singles. And at the time, we just thought, what are you talking about? That doesn't make any sense. You know, you've already released them. It's charted. We're happy with it. Yeah. We were so naive. We said, oh, well, no, but that's great. We're happy. Let's move on to the next single. But they said, no, because a lot of people have been going into the record stores and they can't get hold of the record because it's just been and gone, you know? And so they had the plan to re-release them so that people could go into those record stores. Yeah, I mean, these are the days when, you know, where record stores, I remember. Yeah. And so, and then that's what they did. And it turned out they were right. They were absolutely correct because just when they did that is after that, everything just went crazy.
Did you do a Top of the Pops?
Oh, yeah. We did that quite a few times. All that sort of stuff. And all that was same thing here. We just always starstruck.
Yeah. Do you remember who was on with you when you first sort of started doing those?
Oh, we did quite a few. I remember there were bands like Blur were on in some of the things that we did, you know. And you know, in those early days, Simply Red, all those guys.
Having a hit with Stereotypes and joined Lighthouse Family on their second ever Top of the Pops in February of 1996. Were you comfortable around your peers and musical heroes, Tunde?
I was always, because I was a little bit, and still am, you know, because, you know, when you're, like I told you the story of how we came into it and how we all started.
Yeah.
It was like we were huge admirers of all these artists as well. So you can't only imagine how we were starstruck. Just it was almost like an out-of-body experience, you know, where you're kind of watching all this stuff happening around you. You just stand off to the side and take it all in.
And there must have been situations where those artists that you had long admired were sort of coming up to you saying, oh, I love your record.
Yeah, oh, that started happening. And that was always the same sort of thing. It was just like, oh, wow. I think when those things start happening to you is when you start trying to, I mean, we loved what we did and we were always believing what we did and the philosophy of what we were all about and stuff. But like when you start getting that sort of feedback from other fellow artists and stuff, it kind of drives the point home that, okay, maybe there is something.
Yeah. Start to take this a bit more seriously, maybe.
More seriously. Exactly. Yeah. And throw your heart into it, like, fully.
Was there a particular artist that you met that sort of did hit home for you that, well, if so-and-so says I'm good, then I must be good. It must be worth doing. Was there a particular...
Yeah, I think for me personally, when I remember one of the Jules Holland shows that we did, and on the bill, there was Paul Weller was there on that particular show. There was Simply Red was there, Mick Hucknall and stuff. And I remember at the end of it, because I was quite shy and nervous, you know, all these people, like, you know, just Paul Weller, you know. And I remember at the end of the show, we had to take, you know, there was a group photograph that they had to take. I think they do all these sort of things on like those sort of shows for their part of their promo material and stuff. And I remember standing next to Mick Hucknall. And I think he might have noticed that I was a little bit shy and just nervous about the whole situation. And I remember him pulling me in and just saying, come on, man, you deserve it. Get in there, like, come on, get in here. And that was just so encouraging for me when he said that to me.
Yeah, like, take your place, you've earned it.
Yes, exactly. That's exactly what it was. In his own, he said that to me. I'm not even sure he would remember this, but he said that to me in his own way. And that meant a lot to me.
Real light shining through. number one for Simply Red in 1995. So, Tunde, let's talk about the new music then. It's an album of covers that you've put together. The list is very impressive. You've got Elton John, Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young, James Taylor, Leon Russell, Cat Stevens, Van Morrison, Bill Withers, Barry White. And these are just sort of particular songs of theirs that you've chosen that you love.
Exactly. And we've and like I said, we, you know, those songs are just like timeless classics, beautiful. And I mean, some of the stuff that we've got with the artists featuring on them are like pretty amazing. Hopefully people would think the same when they get to hear it. But yeah, that's what you're going to hear. You're going to hear some amazing artists with me on those songs.
Well, can't wait to hear it. And before we let you go, as we always do, Tunde, for all our guests, we challenge you to come up with a closing song, a particular song that is significant or personal to you in some way because it uplifts or inspires or comforts you.
Yeah, okay. There's a song that I made, like I said, on this covers album. This is one of the few songs, there's only maybe two or three songs that we're not featuring other artists on. And I've just left it with me singing it. And it's a song by Elton John, because I've got this song on my record, you know, by Elton John.
Yeah.
From that album he made called The Tumbleweed Connection.
Yeah.
And it's a song called Come Down in Time.
Oh, okay.
And I think this is when Elton John was at his best.
In the quiet sound. Stars in the night.
Come Down in Time by Elton John. The final track tonight as chosen by our special guest, Tunde Bio. We so appreciate your time.
Thank you. I've enjoyed it. Thank you very much.
Tunde Bio, a speaking voice as lovely as a singing one.